Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Deathlord Arcanist by Shami Stovall, narrated by Shaun Grindell. Chapter 1. Stranded in the Abyss. Although I wanted nothing more than to return to Astra Academy, somehow I was trapped in the Abyssal Hells. Thankfully, I wasn't alone. Twain, my mimic Eldrin, was asleep in my arms, exhausted after our fight with Death Lord Naiad. And it wasn't just Twain who had joined me in this bizarre place. Ashlyn Cross, with her Typhoon Dragon Eldrin, Ekrib, Nini Wonderlin, along with her Reaper, Eldrin Waste, and finally Knovak Gents, with his Unicorn Eldrin, Starling, had all been transported to the Abyssal Hells with me. But where in the Abyssal Hells were we? Everywhere I looked, I glimpsed strange sights. We all stood around a bizarre and freakish mire known as the Wraithborn Orchard. It was a swamp of dark water, where every ripple and wave formed the face of tortured individuals. Under the water, making up most of the ground, was a rocky surface of black and white stones. The black stones were nothing more than swirls and spirals, but the smaller white stones were carved into the shape of human faces, each with different expressions. Some sad, some delighted, some pinched in disgust. Staring into the water only resulted in me staring at the many tiny faces. It disturbed me. The crimson sky had a grey haze of clouds, but we were actually underground. Roots, gigantic roots, for a tree 50 times larger than the treehouse, travelled from the ceiling down into the Wraithborn Orchard. Black waterfalls also cascaded from the ceiling, splashing in the horrid water around us. Probably the most disturbing of all were the smaller roots growing off the larger ones. Each of the tiny roots was shaped like a human hand, and they grasped at anything that moved by. Swaths of strange fireflies danced all around, and occasionally the hands managed to grab one. The instant one did, the root hand receded into the tree, taking the firefly with it. I never saw either again. The chill in the air went straight to my bones. The place smelled of burnt incense and sea salt. Nothing about this place was welcoming. And to make the situation even more tense, there was one last Arcanist here with us, Death Lord Deimos. He stood in the ankle-deep waters not far from us. Deimos' armour was shattered, exposing most of his body. He was taller than most, with a physique that matched his history of war and violence. He was muscled and scarred, and when he moved, Deimos did so with purpose.
"Come," Deimos said to us, "before we lose the option."
He slicked back his black hair with a quick motion of his hands. His eyes disturbed me. They were dark, nearly black, with a hint of yellow in his irises. Deimos had a cutthroat and dangerous demeanour. The Death Lord turned and sloshed through the water.
"We can't go with him," Knovak said.
I faced him. He was mostly unharmed, his fancy evening clothes still intact. They were wet from the mire and wrinkled, but otherwise fine. His plain sandy hair was dishevelled, and he stood close to his unicorn, Starling. The little foal trembled. "We can trust Deimos," I said. Knovak shook his head.
"He tried to kill you. Multiple times.
If he wanted to kill us now, he would have done so. Come on. We don't have any other choices here." I turned to Ashlyn and Nini. For some reason, Nini refused to unmerge with her Reaper. Waist was wrapped around her, his red cloak tight on her shoulders. Three chains hung from him, each holding a lit lantern. His scythe, once rusted and dull, was now as sharp as any masterfully crafted weapon, and seemingly made from gold and silver with rubies in the shaft. The lanterns, they glowed yellow, but powerful blue magic oozed from under Waste's cloak, disturbing and powerful both. Nini didn't have her glasses, but her eyes searched my face for a long moment.
"We should trust Death Lord Deimos," Nini and Waste said together.
She reached up and tucked her red hair into the hood of Waste's cloak.
"Grey is right. If he wanted, he could kill us.
Nini glanced out across the disturbing mire. Deimos waited next to his Eldrin, a monstrous abyssal dragon. It was a beast both terrifying and powerful. The dragon's wings were made of grafted souls, cobwebbed together and a bright sickly blue, the same colour of Waste's new magic. Human faces dotted the wings, their eyes circles, their mouths open as they softly moaned and cried. Deimos's Eldrin turned its massive head to face us. The monstrous dragon had six eyes, and they glanced around the wraith-born orchard, independent of one another. It was difficult to know if the creature was fascinated by us or the strange roots in the area, since it stared at both at the same time. Abyssal dragons had rotted scales and muscles that oozed mucus, but Deimos's Eldrin was in worse shape. One of its front legs had been sliced off just before the elbow. A nub of bone jutted out of the dragon's rotted flesh, and blue ooze dripped from the wound. As I watched, the ooze hardened and formed muscle around the bone, adding to the arm. It appeared the dragon was slowly regrowing its limb, one tortured strand of flesh at a time. "Are you sure we can trust him, Grey?" Ashlyn asked. She shivered. Unlike Knovak, who had near-pristine clothing, Ashlyn had fought against corpses, and their claws had torn her beautiful sapphire gown. Crimson stains and finger-length tears spotted her outfit. Her gown had no sleeves, and her bare shoulders were pale. Ashlyn, even as scruffy as she was, remained beautiful. However, I couldn't allow her to get cold in the middle of the abyssal hells. I removed my school robe and wrapped it around her. She met my gaze as she gently tugged my clothing tightly round her body. "Thank you," Ashlyn whispered. "Don't mention it." I gestured to Deimos. "Trust me. We need to follow the Death Lord. You and Knovak shouldn't be here." I wanted to tell her, "You're both dying," but I kept that to myself. Knovak shook, and his eyes were wide. He wouldn't take the news well, and I couldn't drag a hysterical man around through the abyssal hells while we were trying to avoid a Death Lord. "If you trust him, I will too." Ashlyn stepped closer to me. "Let's go." Her Eldrin, Ekrib, splashed through the mire. His blue scales seemed dull in this environment, even though they were typically vibrant. He lowered his head and sniffed the water.
"This place smells of the salt water found in the midnight depths," Ekrib said.
He lifted his draconic head, and the fins along his back twitched.
"So much salt and death. The bodies of fish and countless whales contaminate this place."
Novak's unicorn whinnied and lifted his legs as though he wanted to fly out of the swamp and never look back. "Knock it off," I snapped. "Come on." I placed my hand on Ashlyn's shoulder. Together, we made our way through the wraith-born orchard. Nini followed close behind. Her reaper merged with her no matter what. Knovak and his unicorn were much slower, but they eventually picked up their pace when I neared the Death Lord and his dragon. Deimos regarded me with a cold glare and then jutted his chin in the direction we needed to go. Deimos didn't walk. His dragon lowered its head, and Deimos took hold. His Eldrin lifted him out of the water and carried him along. Despite missing a limb, the abyssal dragon managed to walk just fine. Its soul-covered wings remained spread, creating an eerie canopy over us as we travelled. The roots of the massive tree were so gnarled and thick, I wondered what kind of plant they even originated from. It was no tree I had ever seen in my life, that I knew for certain. Ashlyn leaned on my arm. We walked without conversing. In a normal swamp, the cries of birds and the chirp of crickets would be common. Here, the moans of anguish and the sharp snaps of something being broken were all I could detect outside our splashes through the water. Deimos's dragon turned around a root where a small island awaited us. The rotting dragon dragged itself up onto the dirt and then lowered its head. Its six eyes gazed, flitting in all directions. Deimos slid off the creature, but held onto its shoulder for support. "Is this the spot?" I asked. It was just an island of dirt next to a giant root. No plants, no animals, no gate, nothing. Why were we here?
The waters of this orchard steal your strength, Deimos stated. We'll wait here for a moment, then we'll swim to our destination.
He pointed with a finger to a root off in the distance.
Once we're in the water, Naiad will abandon her pursuit.
Nini, Knovak and Ashlyn all walked onto the small island. I joined them, but I wasn't sure what we were supposed to do while we waited. If Knovak and Ashlyn only had so much time to live, wasn't waiting here just killing them? Wouldn't it be better to push forward as fast as possible? Then Deimos collapsed to one knee, blood spilling from two injuries along his ribs. He grabbed at his wounds, his fingers practically sliding into his flesh, but it didn't stop the blood flow. A stream of scarlet marked his ruined armor and then fell to the ground, quickly seeping into the dirt. I set Twain down and hurried over to Deimos. Are you okay? I reached out to examine his injuries. Deimos tensed and snarled.
Touch me and your life is forfeit.
I stood straight and withdrew my hand. The others leapt to the far edge of the small, barren island, their eyes wide. Even Ekrib, the mighty typhoon dragon, was shaken. And why wouldn't they be? Deimos's Eldrin seemed just as upset. It lifted its disgusting head and pulled back its cracked lips to showcase the many fangs in its undead mouth. After a long, strained moment, I leaned forward and placed my hands on my knees. I don't know if you're aware, but you're bleeding, I sarcastically whispered. And sure, you're immortal, but it's really demoralizing to see you like this. Deimos met my gaze with the iciest glare.
I'd rather the foul winds of the abyssal hells carry my ashes over this orchard than listen to your blighted jokes.
Harsh, I quipped, but noted. I inched a little closer. Then why don't you let me help you, so we don't have to watch you bleed out like a stuck pig? Deimos didn't reply. He closed his eyes and took a deep breath. A fragment of his soul still resided in me, and his thoughts occasionally crept into my own. He felt worried. Something about his soul. He was damaged. Death Lord Naiad had attempted to graft his soul to her Eldrin, and in the process, she had damaged him at a fundamental level. He wasn't healing as quickly as he should be. I touched my collarbone and felt under my tattered shirt. Vivigul, Silencer of the Damned, the weapon made of abyssal coral, was around my neck and shoulders in the shape of jewelry. Since it had absorbed some of my mimic magic, it had the ability to transform, and I contemplated removing it. Would having Vivigul make you feel better? I asked. Deimos slowly opened his eyes, his expression filled with contempt.
If you condescend to me, child, I will...
I'm being serious, I interjected. Maybe it would make you feel better to have your weapon back. Deimos exhaled. Then he closed his eyes again, his hand red with his own blood. His injuries continued to gush vital fluid.
Hold on to it, he commanded. We may need you to wield it against Naiad, or one of the others.
The others? I whispered.
Death Lord Kallikore or Umbriel. They are both aware I've come here.
How do they know? I was genuinely curious.
Death Lords seldom travel to the first abyss.
I stood straight and glanced around. The first abyss? Nasbit had once told me about the many layers of the abyssal hells, and I struggled for a moment to remember what he had said. There were five layers, and the first was for all souls. It was a place of reincarnation, at least from what I could recall. Is there something I can do to help? I motioned to his wounds. Twain can transform into an abyssal dragon. I could use its magic to fix this.
Feh!
Deimos almost laughed, but he stifled it with a growl.
You're still a student who has yet to master your magic. I have little faith you can mend my damaged soul.
You're a skilled arcanist, aren't you? Again, I inched a little closer until I was near enough to reach out and help. You can guide my hand. You've transferred your skills to me before, right? This'll be easy. Deimos tightened his grip on his injuries, his own fingers seemingly agitating the wounds. The more blood that wept from his ribs, the more splashed onto the dirt, creating a blackish mud. His abyssal dragon lowered its head, its fangs close, its putrid breath hot on my back. I refused to inhale while Deimos deliberated. We needed Deimos. If he became incapacitated or was killed by another Death Lord, there was no way we were navigating out of the abyssal hells by ourselves. So it was either help him get better, or a slow death in the land of the dead. I wasn't going to choose the latter. Chapter 2. Eat Nothing. Deimos closed his eyes.
Very well. Have your mimic transform into an abyssal dragon.
With a nod, I turned around. Twain was still asleep. He was the smallest creature here, just a tiny orange kitten, rolled into a loaf as he slept. He had no tail, just a nub, and his ears were larger than a normal house cat's. He had the ears of a lynx, with tufts of fur at the tips. I called him a kitten, but he was a little bigger than when I had met him, and I wondered how large he would eventually grow. I walked over and scooped him into my arms. Twain purred as he opened his strangely coloured eyes. One was grey, and the other was rosy pink. I patted his head. I know you're tired, but do you think you can transform for just a short while? I scratched behind one of his ears. I'm going to attempt to help Deimos. Twain closed his eyes and yawned.
I think just for a little bit.
Thanks. You're the best. He dismissively waved a paw.
Oh, stop.
When I said nothing else, he twitched his whiskers, opened his eyes in a playful glare and ended his purring.
But actually, keep going. I need more praise.
You're the best mimic in the Abyssal Hells, I said. Although he was the only mimic in the Abyssal Hells, he seemed to accept that as praise enough. Twain resumed his purring. I placed him back on the dirt and then mystically sensed the thread of magic that led to Deimos' Abyssal Dragon. When I tugged it, Twain's body shimmered. I stepped away as he grew larger and larger, his body taking on the massive form of the dragon, including missing an arm. The wings were identical, complete with tortured faces, and I wondered what it meant to duplicate the souls like this. Were they real? No, obviously, but still, it made me wonder. The Arcanist mark on my forehead was usually blank. Everyone else had a picture of their Eldrin wrapped around the points of their stars, but mine was empty, except for when Twain transformed. My mark burned as the image of the Abyssal Dragon appeared etched into my skin. Our tiny island of dirt wasn't large enough for everyone. Deimos's dragon lowered itself back into the brackish waters, its rotting flesh becoming bloated. Knovak, Ashlyn, and Nini watched from afar, all of them at the edge of our land. With the power of the mighty Abyssal Dragon, I returned to Deimos's side. The man remained on one knee, his hand still gripped tight on his injury. He stared at the ground, his eyes unfocused. When I approached, he tensed and shot me a glare.
"Present your hand," he commanded.
I held it out. Deimos grabbed it, his palm cold and sweaty. Although I wanted to ask him what I should be doing, I said nothing, opting to wait instead. He closed his eyes and exhaled. His thoughts drifted to the forefront of my own. Soul manipulation. Abyssal dragon arcanists could manipulate the souls of others. And since a person's soul was the heart of their magic, really the heart of all magic was souls, the abyssal dragons had the ability to warp them. Deimos's soul, it didn't feel right. Not only was it missing a piece, but Naiad's assault on his being had left him exhausted. With Deimos' guidance, I attempted to use my magic to help. Manipulating something I couldn't see was more difficult, however. I closed my eyes, trying to imagine my work. Deimos's soul was like a rag that had been twisted one too many times. Untwisting it required most of my concentration. I couldn't do this quickly. Deimos's thoughts told me souls were fragile. If I messed this up, I could damage him. Or worse, rip his soul straight from his body. As a matter of fact, Deimos's heart beat harder than before. His anxiety permeated his thoughts and emotions. He was afraid, not of me failing, but that I would betray him and attempt to use the abyssal magic to remove his soul and graft it to Twain, which was the only way to kill a Death Lord, really. "You need to stop worrying," I whispered. "It's making everything difficult."
"I'm not worried, child.
You're a terrible liar." After a few moments of untwisting, I was halfway through the process. Unfortunately, my magic waned. I glanced over my shoulder and caught sight of Twain's dragon form. He huffed and collapsed to the dirt, rumbling the little island. A second later, he untransformed, becoming a small orange kitten once again. I pulled my hand away from Deimos's. I'd helped him a little, but not fully repaired his injuries. Deimos exhaled. When he removed his hand from his injury, the flesh began to mend itself. The blood flow slowed, and with his teeth gritted, he managed to stand. He was taller than me, which I hated for some reason, but I tried not to let it influence my thoughts. The fragment of Deimos's soul in my mind allowed him to sense some of my emotions as well. Deimos glowered down at me, but said nothing. "Normally, people say thank you after someone does something nice for them," I said, my tone sardonic. "You can try it now if you want."
"The only reason I'm in this situation is because of you," Deimos darkly stated. "If I had entered the realm of the living when my twin brother Zahn completed his gate of crossing, none of this would have happened. Furthermore, if a fragment of my soul hadn't been sealed away in the realm of your dreams, I wouldn't have gotten caught by Death Lord Naiad, and I never would have been injured."
With a nervous shrug, I said, "Can you really know that for certain, though?"
"The intelligent course of action would be to kill you and take back my weapon and soul."
Deimos tightened one hand into a fist and then released.
"But I will concede you came to my defense when Naiad attacked, despite not needing to interfere. And now, when I was at my weakest, you never faltered in your aid."
"And we really don't want to fight here," I motioned to Twain. "I mean, we're evenly matched, and it would be rough."
"Your mimic is spent," Deimos said. "It would be a short and pathetic fight."
Right, I muttered.
Deimos smirked. "You need to stop worrying. It's making everything difficult."
That actually got me to smile and choke out a laugh. "Oh, you got jokes now, Dee. That's definitely an improvement over threatening to kill me every other sentence." I pointed at him. "Look, let's just agree we're not going to murder each other and get out of here as quickly as possible." Deimos didn't agree or disagree. He simply faced the location of the massive root he had pointed at earlier. With a simple gesture of his bloody hand, he garnered everyone's attention.
"The Wraithborn Orchard takes its souls into the roots. We need to enter one and descend."
His statement left everyone silent for a long while.
"Enter one?" Ashlyn eventually asked. "How?
Are they hollow?"
Knovak rubbed his arms, his teeth chattering.
"They are," Deimos stated.
No one had any other questions after that. What were we supposed to ask? Why? It seemed like it wasn't relevant at the moment. I grabbed Twain and held him close to my chest. He purred, but otherwise offered no interactions. Then we all walked to the edge of the dirt island. Deimos entered the knee-deep waters before everyone else. His blood stained the dark liquid until an opaque cloud slung around the shore.
"We'll need to swim," Deimos said.
He glanced over his shoulder, his expression cold.
"I assume you children know how that's done?"
Everyone slowly nodded.
Good.
Deimos walked a few feet out.
Follow me.
Wait, Ashlyn said as she held up her hand. Deathlord Deimos stopped, but he didn't turn to look at her. Due to our connection, I knew he was already irritated. He didn't much care for interruptions. My Typhoon Dragon magic can help us. Ashlyn motioned for everyone to gather close. I can augment people so they can breathe underwater. That way there's no chance of misfortune.
Thank you, Nini and Waste whispered as one.
Knovak stepped close. Ashlyn touched his arm and augmented him first. Once he had the dragon's ability to breathe water, he stepped away, his stomach grumbling.
Are there fish in the water?
Knovak glanced over at Deimos.
Or something we can find and cook?
A group of fireflies danced down the dirt island, right after Knovak asked his question. The tiny creatures swirled about, first circling Knovak and then heading for the base of a root. As if asking for our collective attention, they bobbed by the bark. It was only then I spotted something growing out of the roots. They were grape-sized berries, each glowing a pale blue. They grew right where the water touched the root, half submerged, half above the water's surface. The little glowing grapes blended well with the environment, but as the fireflies danced, I realized there were more around on every root.
Are those insects helping us?
Knovak asked.
He walked across the dirt island, heading straight for the grapes.
Oh, thank the good stars! I thought everything here would be unrelentingly evil.
Stop! Deimos growled.
Knovak stopped dead in his tracks, his face paling. The Death Lord sloshed the water as he turned on his heel.
Eat nothing here. Do you understand me? Nothing. No matter how tasty it may appear, or how many things may tempt you, consume nothing.
Knovak wrung his hands.
Is something wrong with the fruit?
It isn't fruit, simpleton.
Deimos once again turned on his heel, his back to us.
Everything in the abyssal hells, from the water to the plants to the architecture, is a product of death. Fragments of soul, bones and blood. The abyssal hells have nothing else, no matter what it may disguise itself as.
His statement sent an icy silence through the group.
Everything here was made of souls and gore? Even the glowing berries? What about the fireflies? Ashlyn whispered. Are they souls too?
Deimos nodded once. Knovak leapt back into the company of the group, his skin covered in goosebumps. He practically rubbed shoulders with me in an attempt to distance himself from the glowing berries.
But why would the fireflies try to tempt me? What do they have to gain?
Deimos growled something under his breath. His irritation was reaching an all-time high. But he calmed himself a moment later, probably because we would need to know this information if we were going to survive.
If you consume anything here, your magic will become twisted, infested with the souls of others who desperately want your body. If your Eldrin consumes anything here, it will grow in size and power. It will become an elder creature, and it will lose itself to the lust for power.
As if my stomach wanted to tempt me as well, it knotted in hunger. I rubbed my gut, trying not to think about it. We would be out of here soon, after all. We would be fine.
What if...
Nini and Waste hesitated a moment before asking.
If we ate one another? Since we aren't part of the Abyssal Hells, will the consequences be the same?
That's a morbid question, I said, completely sardonic.
Have anything you want to share with the group, Nini? Her face brightened red as she shook her head.
I was just curious.
You may eat each other if you want,
Deimos said, no mirth in his voice. He was as deadly serious as when he had given us the warning.
I care not. However, if you want to escape, you'll stay close to me, and do exactly as I say.
The others nodded. Ashlyn then augmented the rest of us, her magic soothing. I met her gaze, and her eyes told me she was frightened, but determined to get home. I appreciated that. Unlike Knovak, who I would need to watch, I could count on Ashlyn to have my back. I needed that kind of support in a moment like this.
Chapter 3. The Roots. Death Lord Deimos sloshed forward, away from the barren island. His dragon hobbled after him, walking oddly due to its healing limb. The beast's soul-grafted wings moaned and writhed, creating an eerie chorus of suffering in the otherwise silent abyssal hells. Nini hurried after him, her demeanour different than before. She seemed more comfortable around the Death Lord, and I briefly wondered if it was because she was still merged with waste. That reaper of hers loved death, and perhaps this was his true home.
"What should I do?" Starling asked.
The little unicorn foal trembled at the edge of the island. He pointed with his horn, gesturing to the water. His thin little legs, frail body and glistening mane were not really suited for swimming. He was large enough, about 3 feet at the shoulder, to make this all difficult. Carrying a unicorn foal while trying to swim through normal water would be rough, and apparently these depths sapped strength.
"I'll carry you," Ekrib growled.
He stomped over to the unicorn and then scooped Starling up in his arms.
"You can swim like this?"
Starling kicked his legs, his hooves glittering.
"I'm a typhoon dragon. I can swim under any conditions."
Ekrib cradled the unicorn close as he stomped out into the water. It wasn't yet deep enough for swimming, but the dragon continued to carry the foal regardless. Knovak walked alongside Ekrib, staying close to his Eldrin, despite his own obvious fear. With twain still in my arms, I stepped out into the water. Ashlyn followed, and for a few moments we kept pace with Deimos, but eventually Ashlyn's outfit slowed her down. It was her long flowing gown. The hem was soaked and kept getting caught on the strange stone faces. Pointy noses and sharp chins would hook the hem of her dress's train, and Ashlyn would be yanked back for a moment and a slight tear would appear. "Ugh," Ashlyn said as she yanked her clothing off another rock. I grabbed her upper arm.
"Take twain. I'll fix this."
She lifted an eyebrow, skeptical but trusting. Ashlyn took twain from me and I grabbed Vivigal from my body. The golden weapon click, click, clicked as it transformed from ornate jewellery to a keen sword with a guard made of 6 flared spikes. Vivigal transformed into whatever thing I needed in the moment, but I couldn't change its mass. I wanted a small knife, but a sword was the best I could achieve. I stepped forward.
"May I?" I asked as I gestured to Ashlyn's dress.
She still wore my robes, and she tugged them tightly over her shoulders.
"That's fine."
I knelt and sliced through the tattered blue fabric with Vivigal. I slowly cut away at the dress, removing the lower half to give Ashlyn more room to manoeuvre. Although the weapon was quite sharp, she didn't flinch away when I cut close to her legs. Once finished, I tossed the ruined cloth into the water and stood. Her dress now fell halfway down her thighs, short and frilled outward. Still dirty and torn, and probably spotted with blood, but it was a little too difficult to tell. The lighting in the Abyssal Hells wasn't natural. Everything felt like a bizarre mix of twilight and haze. My robes hung lower than her dress now, and I was tempted to cut those as well, but Ashlyn removed them and then swaddled twain.
"What are you doing?" I asked.
"I'll carry him," she said. With a confident smile, she added, "I'm a typhoon dragon, Arcanist. I can swim under any conditions. You'll need your strength." Ashlyn used the sleeves of the robes to fashion a sling over one shoulder, and then tied twain tightly to her chest, like a mother would keep a child.
"Don't stray from me," Deimos shouted, his voice distant.
I turned around and spotted him by the far root in the orchard, almost out of view due to the lingering haze. Nini and Knovak were close to him, both staring at me with wide eyes.
"Coming,"
I called back. Ashlyn and I splashed our way over. With her legs free, Ashlyn had better mobility, but the stone faces beneath our feet were still uneven. Running was out of the question. With her face slightly pink, she shot me a sidelong glance. "Staring is improper," she said under her breath. "I can look at disgusting plants and mire water, or I could look at a beautiful woman," I said, my tone both sarcastic and questioning, as though I were puzzled over which would be better. Ashlyn didn't reply, but the slight twitch of her lips betrayed her approval of my comment. When we reached Deimos, he glowered at me. Then he pointed to a dark patch of water.
"Here. We swim down and then up into the root. The fingers of rebirth shouldn't reach for you, since you're all still alive. But they might if you panic."
Knovak ran a hand down his paling face.
What are the fingers of rebirth?
Death Lord Deimos motioned with a jut of his chin to the creepy hands sticking out of the roots. They grabbed at fireflies like snakes snatched at their prey.
"They will touch you," Deimos said. "But you mustn't worry. If you panic, they will think you're close to death, and they will strike."
"You probably would have gotten better results if you hadn't told us any of that," I said, trying to hold back the sarcasm. Nini held a golden scythe close.
"I'll swim ahead and cut them all down. My magic is so much stronger now."
Deimos shook his head.
"No. The fingers of rebirth harbor no malice. They are part of an elegant cycle. They are ancient and necessary. Only harm them if you must free yourself. Leave the rest to their sacred duties."
No one replied to that. When I glanced at the hands, I shuddered. Were they ancient? Yes. Were they necessary? Perhaps. But were they elegant? Oh, definitely not. Their gnarled fingers and grasping motions were straight out of my nightmares. Deimos didn't offer any more explanations. He leapt into the water and dove. His dragon followed him. The massive beast slammed into the darkest point of the water and disappeared beneath the surface, the soul wings moaning the whole time. Ekrip went next. He slid into the water as elegantly as a dragon could. With Ashlyn's augmentation, Starling could breathe even while submerged, but the little unicorn still held his breath as Ekrip plunged them both under the surface. Knovak and Nini went afterward. When it was just me and Ashlyn, she glanced over, as if silently asking for reassurance. I transformed Vivigul back into a piece of jewellery that wrapped around my neck and shoulders, and then I gave her a playful shrug. "Better than staying here," I said, grinning. That seemed to ease her anxiety. Ashlyn nodded once and then dove. I went with her, my own heart racing. Swimming wasn't a problem for me. I had lived on an island, after all. Swimming was everyone's favourite pastime. But this wasn't a beautiful beach I was familiar with. This was the abyssal hells. And apparently there were hands and arms ready to grab me if I lost my composure. Not a pleasant thought. The water was dark, and I couldn't really open my eyes. The moans and whispers of Deimos's dragon were clearer now, and the haunting melody of suffering actually served a purpose. I followed the sound. There were more stone-faced rocks, and I clung to them as I pulled my body downward, going deeper and deeper. This was some sort of tunnel. It was a wide tunnel, thankfully, but a tunnel nonetheless. And it was perhaps 20 feet straight down. My ears were starting to hurt. Was Twain okay? I couldn't see. The tunnel turned, and we were no longer going down, just straight. Breathing was fine, thanks to Ashlyn's magic, but I suspected she couldn't maintain this long. How far did we have to go? My thoughts became dark. Then the fingers of rebirth started grabbing at my legs. They clawed at my trousers, the wood cutting through portions of the fabric and leaving splinters in my skin. I tried to think of something other than the fact that I was in the realm of souls and dead people, but it was difficult. The horror of being lost in the abyssal hells was all too real. And then more hands grabbed me. One ripped off my boot. My arms felt tired. All those tiny facts started to pile up. My heart beat harder, like it wanted to slam out of my chest and leave me to the fingers of rebirth. But then Ashlyn grabbed my arm. Had she known I was in trouble? I knew her grip, her long slender fingers, and the calluses she hid on her palms. She tightened her grip on my wrist and swam upward, helping me get away from the grasping hands that lined the bottom of the tunnel. And Ashlyn was right. No one swam like a typhoon dragon arcanist. She manipulated the water around us and shot away from the fingers. We sped through the rock-faced tunnel, angled upward, and then headed for the surface. I was basically dragged along. I kicked my feet to help, but I didn't think it was necessary. When we broke the surface of the water, I gulped down a breath. I didn't need it, but I appreciated it. Ashlyn threw her head back, her long blonde hair halfway slapping me in the face as she did so. I laughed, and she bit her lip, holding back her own chuckle. She lifted Twain's head, even though his body was still swaddled in robes. He looked like a drowned cat, his orange fur so stuck to his body, his head was a fraction the size it normally was. "I hate water," Twain whispered. Then we all glanced upward. The inside of the root was beautiful beyond reason. Chapter 4. Reincarnation. The inside of the root was its own wonderland of beauty. The walls were black with sparkling speckles of blue. Bioluminescent leaves and mushrooms grew out of the roots, larger than any I'd seen before. I felt like I was the size of an ant, their massive forms towering over me, forming a mystical jungle of magic. Everything glowed. Everything. The leaves were a soft green, the mushrooms a pastel orange. Flowers the size of chairs had an inner white light that shone through each petal. And all the plants grew upward, far, far upward. It was like the root had no end. It just went up forever. It was a tower of plant life, complete with vines, moss, and even ferns. Why? I didn't understand. I'd always imagined the abyssal hells as creepy and corpse-filled. Out in the mire, when I had fought Death Lord Naiad, that was the dreamscape I always pictured in my thoughts. Shallow waters, gore, insects, and a haze of blood red that never left the skies. But this was different. It felt warm and inviting, and the plants were so bright I almost couldn't look away. Ashlyn swam me and Twain over to a mushroom cap. It was above the water and wide enough for all three of us to climb on top of it. It glowed with the same dull orange as all the other mushrooms, and I stared at it for a long while, brushing my palm across the matte surface. "What is this place?" I whispered.
"This is the heart of the Wraithborn Orchard," Deathlord Deimos stated.
I snapped my attention upward. Deimos stood on a large blue vine that was growing out of the root's wall. His abyssal dragon was perched on another root just below him, the beast's soul-grafted wings blending in with the glowing environment. It took me a moment of searching to spot both Nini and Knovak. Nini and her reaper were on the large green leaf, close to Deimos's position. She kept her scythe close, but her eyes remained on the Deathlord himself. Knovak, Starling and Ekrib sat on a mushroom cap, similar to me and Ashlyn. Knovak dried his unicorn off and whispered words of encouragement. The little foal trembled the entire time, even as Ekrib patted his back.
"We need to climb our way to the top," Deimos stated.
He motioned to the root's impressive length, and I almost asked how all this could fit under the ocean, but I thought better of it. I seriously doubted this root was actually under the ocean. The entire abyssal hells were like the dreamscape, a place that existed, but perhaps not physically. Obviously, we were here, but it had dreamlike qualities that betrayed its magical nature.
"Can we have a moment?" Knovak asked, his voice unsteady. "I'm not feeling well."
Deimos didn't reply. He didn't start climbing either, so I assumed he didn't mind if we took a break. Besides, he had said Naiad wouldn't pursue us here.
"People are reborn into plants?" Nini asked.
She glanced at the glowing mushrooms and then at the leaves.
"Do plants have souls? I mean, what happens when someone is reborn as a tree?"
Deimos huffed. He crossed his arms and then motioned to the leaves with a tilt of his head.
"Surely you have seen strange vegetation in the living realm? Trees with strange powers? Mushrooms that light fire? These magical plants carry with them a piece of someone once alive."
Starling's ears perked straight up.
"What? Oh no!"
He shook his head.
"You mean, even the midnight berries? The ones that glow?"
Deimos nodded once.
"But I ate so many of them. I was eating people's souls."
That comment caused the Death Lord to chuckle. He shook his head.
"Anything with magic holds a fragment of someone's soul. That is one of the great truths of life. But consuming magic in the realm of the living does nothing. It simply sends the souls back to the abyssal hells, where they can be reincarnated again."
"Why?" I asked as I wrung out my shirt. It seemed like a sad existence. I was going to die and become a weird mushroom? And then, once someone ate me, I'd be reborn again? Only maybe as a magical loaf of bread or something similar? Deimos shot me an icy glare.
"Do they teach you nothing in your academy? The cycle of reincarnation is sacred."
"Pretend I know nothing." I poured water out of my only boot. "Why do I want to be reincarnated?" The inside of the magical root was quite silent. Water dripped from the leaves, falling into the pool of water at the bottom, but otherwise there were no other sounds. Nini, Knovak and Ashlyn remained quiet, each of them with a curious expression. They obviously wanted to know the answer to my question as well.
"When you perish, the parts of your soul that were fulfilled move on," Deimos said.
He turned his attention to the vine under his feet. His gaze softened.
"If you are a proud parent, the part of your soul that wanted children would be satisfied, for example. So, after you die, that part of you wouldn't travel to the abyssal hells. It would go to the stars, never to return."
Knovak ran a hand through his wet hair.
"What about the parts of you that are dissatisfied?"
"Every part of you left unfulfilled is sent to the abyssal hells. All your resentment, unfinished deeds, and passions unquenched are given a new life. One where you will try to satisfy at least one more part of your soul. Perhaps part of you longs for a garden, or to be one with nature. Your soul will be guided here, to live with the forest."
Minnie perked up.
"And the part of you that loved nature would find purpose?"
"Correct,"
Deimos stated.
"And then, once someone ate the mushroom, a part of your soul would go to the stars? And you would keep living lives until your soul found purpose?"
Once again, Deimos nodded. He seemed bored with this entire conversation, like it was knowledge that everyone should know, like how the sky was blue, or how we all needed oxygen to live. But the information was new to me. No one had taught me about the specifics of reincarnation.
"Do you help the souls find a new life?" Nini asked,
her voice quiet but hopeful. Deimos's abyssal dragon exhaled a breath that reeked of blood. Then it spoke.
"Of course, child. A Death Lord whispers to the lost souls and sends them on their way. Souls steeped in vile resentment are sent deeper and deeper to the blackness that consumes all. They are unworthy of finding purpose. Some souls will only be fulfilled by destruction.
That had been my next question. Did murderers and cutthroats get to find their ultimate purpose? Apparently not. They were sent to the deepest parts of the Abyssal Hells, so they couldn't fulfill every aspect of their twisted desires.
Death Lord Naiad and Umbriel both stopped guiding souls centuries ago,
Deimos muttered.
And Kallikore only cares about feeding his eldrin creatures. I alone have been maintaining the flow of souls through the hells.
While the waters left me weak, I wasn't completely useless. I forced myself to stand and took a deep breath. But then, Deimos' words sank into my thoughts. Really? I glanced up at him. You've been continuing to guide souls. He nodded. Why?
Because if I don't, the entire balance of the world will be lost.
Deimos' expression hardened once again, his body tense.
We must open the Abyssal Hells. Find more individuals to bond with abyssal dragons and set everything back in order before it's too late.
You'll form an army once you're in the realm of the living?
Nini asked. Deathlord Deimos grabbed a vine above him. He hoisted himself upward and then stepped onto a large leaf.
Once I'm with my brother, I will claim a swath of territory. That's what is owed to me, for serving my time as a Death Lord in the Abyssal Hells. Once I am ruler, I will form a massive army to fight against those Lackwits.
Who are the Lackwits? I sarcastically asked.
Naiad, Umbriel, and Kallikore.
Right. Deimos continued upward. His dragon followed, but in a different fashion. The mighty beast slammed his claws into the walls of the root and hefted his whole body through the vegetation that grew all around us. What about Starling? Knovak asked. Having a horse body at a time like this was most inconvenient.
I'll help him, Nini stated.
The chains of her reaper reached out like hands. Starling trembled and neighed, his eyes giant with fear. I thought the little unicorn was going to sprint away and throw himself into the water, but instead, Knovak placed a hand on his head and Starling closed his eyes. Nini grabbed Starling with her chains. They wrapped around his body and lifted him, the lanterns dancing within her fire. Starling kept his eyes tightly shut. It looks like we have a lot of climbing ahead of us, Ashlyn whispered as she got to her feet. With one hand, she patted Twain's head, and with the other, she grabbed hold of mine. Do you think you'll make it? I'm a little tired, but that doesn't mean you have to carry me too, I quipped. Ashlyn couldn't hold back a smile. Good, because I was going to suggest we make a race out of it. Always a competition with you. I walked over to the wall of the root and touched the black bark, speckled with sparkling blue. I'll have you know I was the best climber on my entire home island. Ashlyn plunged into the water. When she surfaced, she swam over to the blue vines. With a display of athleticism, she yanked herself straight up and then sat on the edge of the vine. What was that? She sarcastically cupped her ear. I couldn't hear you over the sound of me pulling into the lead. I huffed as I reached up for another mushroom cap. The fungus was both squishy and firm enough to hold my weight. I grabbed the edge and struggled to lift myself all the way. The strange waters of the Abyssal Hells had sapped a lot of my strength, but I refused to look weak in front of Ashlyn. After I managed to roll myself onto the mushroom like a beached whale onto the sand, I sat up and turned my attention to the others. Nini hurried after Deimos. She was already several stories above us and showing no signs of slowing. Why? Was it because she was merged with waste? Her reaper was so much stronger now. Ekrib carried Knovak up onto the leaves, pursuing his Arcanist, and, of course, Ashlyn was using the vines to her advantage. At this rate, I would fall far behind, which meant I needed a new tactic. I couldn't be outdone, after all.
Chapter 5. The Climb. I grabbed the cap of another giant mushroom and hoisted myself, my arms shaking. Ashlyn continued upward, twain in her makeshift sling. After a deep breath, I inched over to a collection of small mushroom caps and used them as stepping stones up the side of the root's interior. 1, 2, 3. It was easier with these tinier mushrooms. I made great time and distance until I came to another collection of large orange shrooms. After a deep breath and a grunt, I pulled myself higher, already regressing my decisions. I should have also asked Nini to carry me. Dignity be damned. Ashlyn glanced over from the opposite side of the inner root, perched on a glowing blue vine, the light illuminating her from below and giving her a hauntingly beautiful expression. "Slowing already?" she playfully asked. I straightened to my posture and waved away her comment. "Never!" She giggled, which was cute, and then continued on her way. I let out a long sigh, wondering how far we would need to travel. Another cluster of smaller mushrooms weren't too far from me, and I walked over to step onto them, but the first one snapped under my weight. I flailed, grabbed a larger mushroom, and almost tumbled off the cap. I made the foolish mistake of glancing down. My heart leapt up into my throat, and my stomach twisted itself into knots. I hated heights. The thought of falling 20 feet back into the creepy water with the fingers of rebirth all but made me vomit. It took me a few seconds of calming breaths to even regain my focus. Why was I so afraid? What was wrong with me? And according to the mother of shapeshifters, if I was ever going to have Twain become a true form mimic, I would need to defeat the most ancient shapeshifter, fear. So I had to overcome this. I just wasn't sure how. Grey? I gulped down a breath and glanced over. Ashlyn had climbed around the inner root and landed on one of the nearby mushrooms. She was barefoot and slowly scooted across an orange cap as she made her way over to me. "Are you okay?" she asked, her eyebrows knitted. "What happened?" I forced a chuckle and shrugged. "I'm fine. Totally fine." "Your white knuckle grip says otherwise," Ashlyn quipped. She was right. I held myself tightly to the mushroom growing out of the side of the root, my feet planted firmly on the cap under me. Ashlyn, once by my side, touched my shoulder. "I thought you said you were the best climber on your island. Well, in case you haven't cracked the case of Grey is very afraid of heights, let me be the first to tell you my claim was a lie." With calm and gentle movements, she took hold of my wrist and guided me away from the mushroom wall. Then Ashlyn pointed to the path she had taken over and the many vines that grew out of the wall, leading upward. With her help, she took me on a path across a few more caps, and then up a larger vine with handhold indents. Ashlyn climbed the glowing blue vine first, and I waited for her to finish. Not because I was afraid, but because I had cut her dress rather short, and I didn't want to accidentally glance up and catch an eyeful of her. That didn't stop my imagination, but I had the common sense not to act out stupid fantasies. If I was going to be a husband, I had to embody the part. A dashing nobleman. I almost laughed. It didn't really sound like me. "Grey, are you coming?" I grabbed the vine and forced myself not to look down. "Yup." "What were you thinking about?" Ashlyn asked. I scaled the last of the vine and crawled onto a gigantic fern leaf. It grew out of one wall and into another, creating a hammock-like plateau I was capable of standing on. This place was bizarre. "I'm not thinking of much," I said, eyeing our surroundings. "You had an odd smirk on your face."
With a single laugh, I shook my head.
Oh, that!
I offered her a smile.
I was thinking you were beautiful, but trying not to stare. Sorry.
Ashlyn patted Twain's orange head. He purred, but kept his eyes shut, his little body tucked away in the sling. Ashlyn didn't say anything else after my comment. She just motioned to another set of vines that led to an even bigger fern above us. To my surprise, Knovak, Starling, Ekrib, Nini and Deimos were all waiting there, as though Ashlyn and I had fallen so far behind they were now worried. I rushed over to the vines and pulled myself up, my strength gradually returning. This route's visuals delighted me. I just wished it didn't require swimming through nightmarish water to get into here. I climbed onto the second humongous fern leaf and rolled across its glowing emerald surface. Ashlyn followed soon after, and when her weight was added to the foliage, the whole leaf shook, bouncing people and creatures around.
Whoa!
Knovak said with a laugh. Even Ekrib smiled and enjoyed the slight amount of bouncing. Everyone did, except for Deimos, who stood at the very edge of the fern leaf, his hand pressed heavily against the root wall, his expression one of irritation.
You all didn't need to stop for us. I motioned to Ashlyn and then myself. We're capable grown-ups, thank you very much.
Knovak pulled his unicorn eldrin close.
We didn't stop for you two. We stopped because of Starling. He hasn't been feeling well.
The little unicorn softly neighed. He didn't look sick to me, but his legs trembled and his ears hung low. Was he afraid? I would believe that. This place, while mystical and beautiful, still had a moderate hint of menace.
We should rest for a moment, Nini and Waste said as one.
Since everyone else was sitting, I carefully parked myself near Ekrib and leaned on my arms.
Where's the abyssal dragon? What's his name?
Deimos turned to glower at me.
My Eldrin has gone ahead to search for the exact location, and his name is Hector. But common Arcanists and their ilk should never address him by his name without his permission.
Hector?
Ashlyn asked. She walked over and then sat next to me, so close we touched.
That's the cutest name ever. My nephew is named Hector.
Deimos didn't have a response to that. He turned away, his unnaturally yellow eyes fixed in mild confusion. I suspected it had been thousands of years since this man had really interacted with anyone who wasn't a fellow Deathlord trapped in a freakish underwater hellscape. While Knovak stroked the mane of his Eldrin, I relaxed a bit. Ashlyn did as well. She pressed her shoulder against mine and even rested a hand on my knee, which wasn't fair. If I did any of that, someone here would yell foul play. She was engaged, after all. But no one said anything when she did it. I wasn't about to say anything, either. I held back a smile as I glanced over at her. In a silent conversation, which we conducted with only subtle looks and raised eyebrows, I asked if she was okay with this level of public display, to which Ashlyn just squeezed my knee with a strong grip and then relaxed. She wasn't concerned about the others.
We're definitely going to make it out of here, right?
Knovak asked. I nodded and then half shrugged as I turned my attention to Deimos.
Right, Dee?
He didn't dignify that question with a response.
We'll make it out of the hells, Nini and Waste said.
She held her gaudy weapon close to her body.
I miss Sorin. I want nothing more than to see him.
When Nini turned her gaze to Ashlyn and me, I almost felt guilty. In order to take the focus off me and Ashlyn, I asked,
So, Deimos, when you were a normal Arcanist, like the rest of us chumps, did you ever court a nice young lord or lady?
I lifted an eyebrow. Or anyone, really. This question also seemed to intrigue everyone here. They shifted around to face Deathlord Deimos, their eyes bright with curiosity.
The city I grew up in was known for its hedonism,
Deimos stated matter-of-factly.
We were looked down upon and thought of as degenerates.
He cracked his knuckles, his gaze dumb focus as he clearly mulled over ancient memories.
My mere status as street urchin, and then a slave soldier, and finally a usurper, prevented me from ever having anything close to a normal relationship.
You were looked down upon?
Knovak smoothed his hair, his attention momentarily darting to his Eldrin. Then he asked,
Have you kissed anyone at least?
Deimos laughed. Like, really laughed. It came out of nowhere, like even he couldn't believe he had been asked such a question. It took him a few seconds to calm himself, his laughter turning into something dark right at the end.
Ah, I see I have misled you, Deimos said. When I said I had abstained from normal relationships, I wasn't claiming to have been chaste.
That intrigued me, but I was also hesitant to continue the conversation. Deimos was the type of person who didn't mind sharing all the details, and I was pretty sure I didn't want the nitty-gritty, but I was curious. So, did you fancy anyone? I asked. But despite his normal openness, Deimos didn't answer this question. He remained unusually silent on the matter. Knovak, obviously invested in getting the answers, asked,
Did you attend any parties?
In my day, we went to rapture houses, Deimos drawled.
His tone now one of disinterest, like this conversation was boring him.
We often had competitions to see which of us could pleasure the most individuals before we finally finished ourselves.
He shrugged with one shoulder.
That was the closest we came to having a party.
This was the type of nitty-gritty I definitely wanted to avoid. The less I heard about these rapture houses, the better. Even Ashlyn seemed a little uncomfortable, her cheeks pink. Knovak lifted both his eyebrows.
Well, what was the highest number of people?
Knovak, I hissed. Don't ask that. What's wrong with you?
18, Deimos replied,
again with very little interest. Knovak balked and waved a hand.
18? No, you're lying. That's impossible.
These people in the rapture houses,
Nini began, her voice breathy.
Were they beautiful?
No.
Stop that, I snapped. I waved my hand around, getting everyone's attention.
Stop asking him questions. He'll answer them, and sometimes with way too much detail. I heard about baby graves one time because I asked too many things. Stop asking him about this.
Ekrib craned his head over and snorted on me.
You started this conversation, he said,
and I regret doing that. Are you happy now?
Deimos grumbled something. Then he snapped his fingers twice, regaining everyone's attention.
My brother's schemes won't wait. If you're done recouping, we should move.
The others got to their feet, the fern jiggling as we all stood at once. Ashlyn fell a bit onto me, and when I caught her, I knew it was all a sham. I wrapped my hand around her waist to help her, and she steadied herself, taking much longer to do so than normal. I smirked, and she coyly smiled back. Deathlord Deimos, in a feat of athleticism, pulled himself up onto another glowing blue vine, and then leapt onto the highest fern leaf. Above him, the vegetation was shifting and becoming more tree-like. Giant star leaves created a canopy above. That was our destination, apparently.
Come on, I whispered to Ashlyn. We better stick close, just in case we need to help each other up these perilous plants.
Chapter 6. The Elder Toad. Nini stepped closer to Knovak and his unicorn, her chains reaching out for Starling. But Knovak moved into the way and held up an arm.
No, he snapped. I think your chains are what's making Starling unwell.
Nini's eyes widened, her gaze searching Novak's. For a long moment, they said nothing to each other, and everyone waited with bated breath. Was Nini's new Reaper form somehow hurting the little unicorn? Just through proximity?
You're right, Nini whispered.
Her attention fell to the glowing fern leaf beneath our feet.
I'm sorry. I hadn't even thought about it. I shouldn't touch anyone here.
That was disturbing, to say the least. Nini's death powers were obviously quite strong. I wondered what Soren would say once we got back to him. Ekrib growled, his scales flaring as he stared down at Starling.
So, what are we going to do about the horse?
Hey! Novak wrapped his arms around Starling's neck. Don't talk to him like that.
He doesn't have thumbs, and just like horses, he can't climb.
Which was a point. How would we take Starling up if Nini couldn't carry him with her chains? The only real solution seemed to be for one of the dragons to do it, and since Hector was already much further up, that left Ekrib. The typhoon dragon must have come to the same realization at the same time I did, because his scales flattened as he muttered,
"Very well, I'll do it."
With careful movements, so as not to hurt Starling, Ekrib picked up the unicorn with his claws. Then he held Starling close to his scaled chest. The little foal trembled, but otherwise didn't protest.
Be gentle,
Novak said. Ekrib snorted in response. With that taken care of, Nini went up first, followed by Novak, who glanced over his shoulder every 2 seconds to watch as Ekrib went up behind him. Ashlyn and I went next, with Twain still tucked comfortably in her makeshift sling. I helped Ashlyn climb onto a large leaf, and once her feet were firmly planted on a thick branch, she turned around and offered her hand to guide me. We did this a few times, one branch and leaf combo after another. The star-shaped foliage glowed golden, and this part of the root's interior seemed more fantastical than anything we had seen before. Once up another 10 feet, Ashlyn pulled me onto a narrow branch that was almost too small for the both of us. We stood close, practically squished together, and I had to brace myself on the root wall in order not to tumble off. Ashlyn was close, her breath on my face, her gaze meeting mine. She grabbed my shoulders to steady herself. The others were climbing faster than us, even Ekrib with his extra burden, leaving me and Ashlyn quite alone. She leaned forward, inching our faces ever closer.
This isn't like you, I whispered with a smile. Is something about the abyssal hells causing you to abandon all regard for everyone else's opinion?
Ashlyn slowly pushed herself away. She kept her hands on my shoulders, but held me at arm's length.
What if we don't make it out of here? She asked, her tone hard.
We'll make it.
But what if we don't? Will I really be the woman who lived a whole life not doing anything she wanted? Not even one thing for myself?
I saw her point.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.